year, after your first meeting in the year, we want to come to you. We believe that Nigeria, at this point in time, need the voice of great people like you, highly opinionated, knowledgeable leaders like you, to give us direction. Sir, at this point in time in Nigeria, how will you define the country, especially as regard the 2 years in power of President Muhammad Buhari and the APC as a party, and what happened last December, the oil foil in Brooklyn that led to a whole lot of stagnated situations, people couldn't travel, a whole lot of problems, and people are not saying a whole lot of things. Then we are also witnessing the killings across the country now. Mm. Do you want to say that 103 years of amalgamated unity is a profit, and 57 years of independence, is it a good deal or a bad deal? Will you say the amalgamation of Nigeria is a mistake or a mission? So first and foremost, let's have a view about Nigeria at 57, sir.
Well, thank you so much, Brother Sabe. It's a pleasure welcoming you and the crew to the Citadel of Higher Learning. You permit me to set record straight. You did say YABA College of Technology, in all of the very wonderful ways and manner you portrayed it, is one of the first. It is the first.
Even more than UI.
Of course.
It is the first. The first set of students in the University of Ibadan were taken away from YABA College of Technology here in 1948 to form the University of Ibadan. So let's set record straight.
Sorry for that, sir.
Right.
I think I've got that. As a honor.
You will also permit me to immediately say on my left is Builder Yemi Oshibaju, the General Secretary of the Alumni Association. And to my immediate right is Pastor Nureni Alabi, the first vice president of the YABA College of Technology Alumni Association. If one has been able to achieve whatever one is ascribed to have achieved in leading this institution, it's because I've been blessed with lieutenants like these two gentlemen. You find that both formally and informally, we are always 2 days ago, we were together from about 10 a.m. till almost 4 p.m. Brainstorming on some of the issues that you have raised here, because you see, no institution can exist in an atmosphere of confusion that the Nigerian nation seems to have found itself. So you cannot say you're leading an institution like this in a confused environment and you're not concerned. And I want to also say that, interestingly, you're taking me on a topic I found myself speaking on at the 70th anniversary of YABA College of Technology. It will interest you. First and foremost, you mentioned over after 103 years of amalgamation. Is it a mistake or a mission?
Yes, sir.
First and foremost, let me tell you, the man who amalgamated this country, if you care, I'm going to give you a book.
I won't mind, sir.
I'm going to give you a book.
I won't mind, sir.
That will put a lie to who Lord Lugard is. It's only unfortunate that most of us don't do research. We don't know where we are coming from. So we do not appreciate how we got to where we are. So it becomes difficult to properly plan where we should be heading for. You know, when you told me you needed to send field questions so that I can prepare myself, I said, no, I'm not going to write WAEC. Whatever questions you're going to ask me and I cannot answer extemporary,
yes,
is how we fake ourselves.
Yes, sir.
Let me talk as I am.
Yes, sir. You said so, sir.
First and foremost, I will tell you that amalgamation itself was premised on three reasons.
What are the reasons, sir?
Number one, the Northern Protectorate was being operated by the British government at a loss.
Oh.
And the Southern Protectorate was being run at a surplus. And it is against British government policy that any of its colonies should be funded from its treasury. So the major thrust of the amalgamation was economic. So they had to match the Northern Protectorate and Southern Protectorate so as to bring about a balance. The second, and which many people do not even care to find out, is the policy on our railways. The Northern Protectorate was landlocked.
Okay.
So, from the coastal region, from the Lagos colony, to move goods and whatever into the northern part of Nigeria, they need a railway policy that will allow a unity between the Southern Protectorate and the Northern Protectorate.
Free movement of trade,
right,
and business.
Right. Second.
Yes, sir.
The third one, I can't immediately remember his name, but in the book I will give to you, you'll find it there. He said if the Northern Protectorate and Southern Protectorate had not been brought together or matched together, there would probably have been a civil war between the British colonialists up north and those in the south. Because you have to remember, the Southern Protectorate, which principally has the Lagos colony as the fulcrum,
yep,
had the fewer landed people here.
Intelligentsias.
They were here in Lagos. They were few.
Okay, sir.
And majorly, again, I'll tell you, there were about three prongs for what led to the amalgamation and why Lugard succeeded. It succeeded in the sense that, number one, most of the people felt, oh, by becoming citizens under the British government,
yes, sir,
their lot will be better. The fewer who were educated, probably school sat and also what have you, saw opportunity to get into the police force, to get into the military, to get into this, to become clerks under the white, and all of these so-called white-collar jobs, and what have you.
Understand now.
Thirdly, the native authority believe they have become junior partners under the British in the indirect rule system. So it was not an altruistic reason. The amalgamation was not based on the advancement of Nigeria. You know, I'm talking without prepare. I didn't know the area in which you want to take me.
Yes, sir.
But this is what I've buried my life into. How can I call myself a Nigerian citizen and I don't know the history of the country? How many Nigerians can talk the way I'm talking without preparing?
This is the first time I've seen that kind of thing.
Wonderful. Secondly, we need to also take into consideration that by bringing together the Northern and Southern Protectorate,
okay,
the British had a people in their hand. And that was why one of our eminent leaders said the essence of, I'm a pastor,
okay, sir,
and yet I'm going to say this,
yes,
said the essence of Nigeria finding itself under British rule brought us three tragedies. What he called the Trinitarian tragedy. Trinitarian tragedy.
Yeah,
of mission, trade, and slavery.
The same slavery again, recurring decimal.
Wait, what? How did they start? They started with mission,
yes, sir,
or trade, whichever we want to put it. When Mungo Park, when Richard Landa and John Landa,
wow,
came around,
yeah,
and not the rest of it, after the advent of Mungo Park discovering the Niger,
yeah,
what did they form? The Royal Niger Company.
Yes, sir.
Do you know that the entire Northern Protectorate was bought for £46,000? Including land, people, goats, and what have you. It's there in history, if you want to search. They thought we were bought. And that's why I'm talking about we were entering, knowingly or unknowingly, selling ourselves off. So we need to understand that. And secondly, you need to go and look between 1904, when this country was amalgamated, and 1960, when we had between the amalgamation and the time of independence.
Yeah, that was 1960.
1960, when we had independence.
Yeah.
I want to say when did we have the first constitution from the time of amalgamation? It was 1923.
1923.
What we call the Richard's Constitution.
Yeah.
Right. And the second constitution after that did not come until 1946. Which means for a period of about how many years? 33 years, we had only one constitution. And that constitution came. So Nigeria, Northern and Southern Protectorate was ruled by Flora Lugard, the wife of Lugard, and Lugard.
That's the one that called the name Nigeria.
Right.
Okay.
Now, even the Richard Constitution that came in 1923 was because of some agitations. So look, in under what are we ruling? Under what? When you talk of fraud and arson and all that, go into history. The first arson happened under Lugard.
Arson.
That's to now burn the property when the others are coming.
Damage.
I can be going. If I knew we are going to go into this type of debt, I would have, like I told you, I have books.
Hmm.
And interestingly, he saw what is happening now. He told me, he said, probably I would have allowed you to send the questions. Maybe I will be making references to some issues and others. Mm-hmm. If you need to, I can ask you, come around. I will be showing you and citing dates, names, and what I to all what I'm saying, and ask you to go and do a research on it.
So you want to say it's a fairy weather relationship?
The amalgamation of the Northern and Southern Protectorate was not to advance this nation. It was to benefit the British government.
Could we say that?
And that was why I come. Let me round this up. It's important. I want you to notice what I'm saying.
Okay,
I said between 1914 and 1946. A period of about 33 years or thereabouts, there was only one constitution in 1923. Now, watch it, between 1946 and 1951, there was a constitution in 1946, there was another one in 1951, there was another one in 1954, then there was the 1960 constitutional constitution.
Hmm.
So, which means between a period of 40 years, 46 to 1960, four constitutions were quickly.
Hmm.
What brought about that? Because after the Second World War, our people became enlightened.
Yes, sir.
They returned and they were asking questions.
That was the kind of renaissance.
So that was where we now begin to understand, look, what is happening? Quickly, see the rapidity of the constitutions that now, was the Littleton Constitution, the Clifford Constitution, the McPherson Constitution, and then the Constitutional Constitution in 1960. How many of us, even those of us who have gone to university and what have you, read all of these things, know where we are coming from? How many? I'm asking a very bold question.
No. A lot of people, when they are graduates, then it ends there. They are looking for bread and butter.
So, we need to know, why was it, for a period of about 33 years, only one constitution was done? Because we were not actually being administered as a nation.
But as
we were just seen as a geographical expression.
Maybe business venture.
Business venture. Owned by Royal Niger Company. That's another kettle of fish. How Lugard outsmarted the Royal Niger Company to bring about that amalgamation. That's another. We can go into that now.
Yeah, can we call Lugard a hero or
Lugard, as far as I'm concerned, is a villain.
Villain.
Hmm. Want me to use that word?
I think that's a very positive.
And I can defend myself.
Tribal word. At least it's still very.
So when people talk about the amalgamation and what have you, my final take is that it's not to the interest of the Nigerian nation. Albeit.
Okay, sir.
Somehow or the other, I want to believe nothing happens accidentally. Because sometimes out of darkness comes light.
Right. Yeah.
It could have started on that faulty premise. And mark you, you have to take into consideration that even before the advent of Lugard and the amalgamation, historically, people of the geographical expression called Nigeria have been interacting far beyond the 1884-1885
Berlin Conference.
That partitioned the whole of Africa amongst the Germans, the British, and the French.
Yeah.
We need to put history in perspective.
Yeah.
I like to talk in context.
That's fantastic, sir.
We were relating.
Somehow.
We were interacting. And yes.
Commerce.
What about the trans-Saharan trade?
Trans-Atlantic.
Wonderful.
Yeah. Okay.
We were interacting. We were there.
So that means we were friendly to some extent.
There was relationship.
Okay, sir. So at what time was that relationship crucified or punctured or?
You see, unfortunately, you are going to take me to so many areas that we cannot cover in an interview like this.
Okay, no problem.
Because you may not believe it that what is eventually now called BOkO Haram. Was actually a problem Lugard engineer. How many of us know that?
Nobody.
Fine. Let me tell you. What is the meaning of Boko Haram? Boko Haram is because when Ajayi Crowder,
Bishop Samuel
Ajayi Crowder, was now evangelizing the Niger area and trying to go up north with some other missionaries, Lugard resisted them. And
how?
He instigated.
But Lugard is a Christian.
What are you talking about?
British person.
Lugard was just a soldier. Do you know, so several times he kept on changing titles. When he gives a report today, he's a colonel, tomorrow is a major general, tomorrow is this. How many of us know that about Lugard? That's a civilian.
So can we call him the soldier of fortune?
Look, it's unfortunate. I took pains to ask myself these questions. And look, what exactly is our problem? And unless you identify a problem, you can solve it.
Because it looks like it
does. Look, my dear brother, you have asked a very interesting question. Okay. Because unfortunately, some of us think our problem is tribal. And I said no.
Okay.
What exactly is the meaning of when you say tribe? Tribe, simply defined, means collection of several families.
Oh, yes.
Under probably one clan or headship or whatever, and probably they share the same cultural and linguistic affinities.
Hmm.
And in any case, every facet of humanity starts from the unit of the family,
yes,
to become a clan, a tribe, or a nation, or whatever.
Hmm.
It is the use to which you put your tribal affiliation that should be questioned.
Hmm.
It's not about either this is a Yoruba person, that's an Hausa person. Definitely you must evolve from a family. That family must evolve from a particular context, or cultural context, or linguistic context, and what have you. And you need to interrelate with one another. But unfortunately, these people saw the seed of divide and rule amongst ourselves, and we took it hook, line, and sinker. We did not ask ourselves, what is the strength in our relationship? What are our weaknesses? Like I was saying, Boko Haram.
Yeah, Boko Haram and Lugard.
So when Ajayi Crowder and some of the other early missionaries were trying to infiltrate the North with education and what have you, he engineered resistance, and the word Boko came from the word, we don't want book. Hello? Book is Boko. Boko.
So that was the local language. The
right.
Dialect against
Boko. Right. They were calling book Boko.
Western education.
Of Boko Haram. Resistance of book of Western education was sown from that period.
And by Lord Lugard.
And his cohorts.
Because of their.
Because they wanted to, they realized that they, like I told you, I said there was conflict of interest between the Northern Protectorate and the Southern Protectorate, because those who were in the South here, they were educated. They had people from Brazil, slaves returning from Brazil, slaves returning from Sierra Leone, from Ghana, from all over. So Lagos colony was highly articulate.
I understand now.
And they were not going to be subjected to some of the rubbish you were doing up north.
I understand now.
So when missionaries from here want to go up north, he was resisting them. They needed to get some permission and answer, which will not be given out. Look, go and research. Prove me wrong.
This is news.
Prove me wrong.
This is very, very interesting, sir. I can't believe this.
So our independence.
So let me say, Lord Lugard can be defined as a villain. And there was this argument that he put it in the document that if we live together for 100 years and there's no positivity, there's no progress, we could also sit down, we can separate. So how do you treat that? How do you see that?
My dear brother, wait a moment. Let's simplify the issue.
Huh.
We don't need to make things difficult for us. Even though, as a pastor,
okay, sir,
the Bible teaches me that what the Lord has joined together, let no man put asunder. No, wait, now I'm going.
Well, that's the marriage.
The marriage institution is what I want to use as my basis.
Okay, sir.
As sacrosanct as the marriage institution is, do you know it gets to a point where when the husband and wife realize that there's a threat to life of the one party. I'm sorry to be direct. This issue of a wife that stabbed the husband to death, I'm not going to mention him. What would have been better? Would it have been better if they separated, or the man that has now lost his life?
The separation would have been better.
It would have been better.
Yes, sir. Somehow, logically.
And do you know what led to that? Because there must have been breakdown in communication. The issue we're saying that we're treating in Nigeria is that people are refusing to communicate. It is better for you to have agitation, to listen to people's complaints. Even my child at home, if I come to punish my child and I say, you must not cry. Hello?
Hello, sir. Yes, sir.
I'm flogging a child. Yes. And I say, you must not cry. Then you know what they do to us? They say,
yes.
They say, what is it? And they are beating you.
That's also crazy, sir. No, they won't crazy, sir.
So, what people are saying, I'm sorry, I don't want to put any name to anything and what have you, but if components part of a body says, let us sit down and talk. How do we relate in this house? Who pays school fees? Who takes the child to school? Who comes home to prepare the meal? Who shares the meal? How do we share it? Which side of the bed are we going to sleep? Is that not to bring about peace at home?
Yes, sir.
And you said, no, mama, stop. See, you have been sitting in this, you have been sleeping in the sitting room since we came to this house. You must sleep in the sitting room, whether mosquito is there or not. That is your lot.
That's crazy, sir.
And somebody said, no, that kitchen. So, you need, what would have been better for them to come together? I don't know what name you want to call it. I'm only just giving illustration.
We are coming, yes, sir.
You are getting my point.
Yeah, we're going to restructure this.
I don't know. I'm not talking about.
No. I was coming there, really. Yes, I was coming there because you are talking about restructuring.
No, I'm not. I didn't say anything. I'm only talking about.
No, your illustration is taking us to that junction because I interviewed General Jembe one. That was 4 months ago in Ibadan. And I asked him, I said, what is your definition of restructuring? And he said, you can wake up one day in your house and say, okay, I don't want the 3 sitters to be there again. Let's take it this side. The cupboard should be moved this side. The fridge should be moved this side. Then you structure your parlor.
Hey, was I at that interview?
No, you are there. I think you are there. That was the bad. Then
I'm wondering why he's using my illustration.
Hey, that was General Jembe for you. Was saying that in Ibadan. That was 4 months ago. Then I was in General Samoma. That was 2 weeks ago in Abuja. This is the general, the former minister of science and technology. And it was talking about the eggs that lay, the goose egg that lays the golden egg, and the one that's eating the egg and all that. That we have to rearrange the economic, transactions of this country, profit sharing and all that. And I also was with the, I think, Mingakaka, Senator Mingakaka. That was last week.
In Lagos State.
Yes, it was in Lagos. I spoke to him. And he was also talking about we coming to sit and look at who is taking what, where what goes, and where what comes. And nobody was trying to talk about let us break away. Because I was looking for another
reason. It's not about breaking away. I told you what nothing happens accidentally.
Okay, sir.
I told you, maybe you're not listening to me. I told you, even if our amalgamation has come based on wrong premise, but light comes sometimes out of darkness. And in any case, I now nailed it. I said we have coexisted long before 1884. Why are you listening to that?
Prior to 1885.
Right. We have coexisted. Hmm. So it's not about our coexistence. It's about the fact that when we were now formally merged together, the basis and tenets of our being merged together were not clearly defined. And that's why we keep on having, when it dawned on people that, look, we have been ruled with a constitution made in 1923 and it's not even properly defined. And in any case, when they were now going to carve the Northern and Southern Protectorate, mark you, what did they do? The Northern Protectorate stood as it is, the Southern Protectorate was now broken into the East and the West. Yes, look, there are things we should no longer hide from ourselves.
So there was already
a default
from the beginning.
So, but I'm now saying let's move beyond all of that.
Okay.
Because after 57 years of existence, we should stop being a nation that expects the children from crèche,
yes sir,
or nursery,
okay,
or at the worst when they get to primary school to be able to count sequentially and numerically. 1, 2, 3, 4. Am I correct?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
I expect my child to be able to count, and yet a nation that cannot say this is the number of people that are my citizens. Mm. We keep on guessing.
Will you say the census itself was also a fraud because there was a time?
No, because we are a nation that has refused to grow. That's what I'm saying. Look, I am not interested in the mistakes that were made by Lugard.
Okay, sir.
That's what I told you.
Okay.
I am saying we are now 57 years of age.
You think we're going to have a good 60-year celebration? Because just 3 years away to 60. Do you think we can boastfully celebrate 60 and say, okay, we are number one in Africa, or we are prominently recognized in the world? Do you think we're going to have a 60-year
celebration? Let me again tell you.
Yes, sir.
In fact, in this place, my lieutenant here will tell you, I am called an incurable optimist.
Okay. Are you a fatalist?
No.
Okay.
When I say I'm an optimist, when people see a glass of water as half empty, I see it as half full.
Okay.
Or, most likely, when I say it's half full, that means I'm expecting it to be filled up, not to reduce. So, I believe that this nation, somehow or the other, would outgrow its problems. I see somebody as committed as you, because when young ones like you begin to ask the right questions, you will get the right answer. It is because till recent time, Nigerians were not asking the right questions. We have allowed our leadership. Any case, let me also quickly point this out.
Okay,
let me again point this out.
Okay, sir.
From amalgamation of the Northern and Southern Protectorate till date, we have continued to mistake constituted authority for constitutional authority.
Okay, I can't understand. We've continued to mistake
constituted authority for constitutional authority.
So what is the difference between constituted authority and constitutional? Because I remember the governor of Oyo State, the other day when students were agitating for better life in Lautech, he was saying, I am the considered authority, so you have no right to even come and ask me those stupid questions. So what's the difference between constituted authority and constitutional authority?
You see what I'm saying? A man sees himself as constituted. Yes, he could be right.
No, the governor was...
Wait a minute.
No,
yeah,
the
he could be... Bobby,
yeah.
Wait now, he could be right.
Okay,
he's a constituted authority, but he's not a constitutional authority. When you are constituted, you could be constituted through military. You could be constituted through enemies.
Understand.
You could even impose yourself.
Autocracy.
That's constituted, and we know that this is the authority. There are no parameter for us to weigh whether that constituted authority is on the right side or the wrong side. But when you talk of constitutional authority, everybody knows the A, the B, the C. That's what you call constitution.
Yes, sir.
It's clearly written.
Yes, sir.
I know the parameters to which I want to assess the person who is in a position, because he is operating by the structures laid down in the constitution. So it's a difference. But most times, like I said, and I'm sure you agree with me, we don't even know there's a difference between somebody seeing himself as a constituted authority, and you've cited an example, and constitutional authority. Constitutional authority can be questioned. But most times, constituted authority is difficult to question.
How so? Okay,
he sees himself as the constitution. A constitution that is unwritten.
Yes.
And that was why Lugard ruled in what? Now I want to ask you, the amalgamation, what do you call it? It's a proclamation.
Yes, of course, a proclamation indeed.
It was a proclamation
because it was just
what about
the submission of a document.
He proclaimed.
Yeah.
He proclaimed the Northern and Southern Protectorate as one. It was a proclamation. There are no constitution
to back it up.
In fact, it took how many years?
Almost 33 years.
Until 1923, okay, before we had one constitution to govern the Northern and Southern Protectorate.
That was even a fraud, sir.
Wonderful.
A moral fraud.
So, are you getting what I'm painting?
Yes, I'm getting.
So, if we are coming from all of those 40 foundations, and Matthew said, if the foundation be destroyed, what can the righteous can do?
That's,
and that's why it seems as if all of the things we keep on papering over cracks. We don't look at ourselves in the face, but some of us, somebody like me, I've laid my life on the line several times. As president of the Students' Union of this same college, I have stood on the Korodu Road to tell a sitting president of this country and his visitor, Ahmadu Ahidjo, they will not pass through the board, and they did not.
Oh, that's General Olamide?
No, Shehu Shagari,
okay, Shehu
and Ahmadu Ahidjo in 1981.
That's a long time ago. That's a very historic one.
So, I have been part of this history. And I know that in 1978, I was one of those who led the struggle on this Nigerian streets about petroleum or no petroleum. We are still 1977.
To this time.
Right.
Almost 40-something years.
Right. So, what am I saying to you, my brother? Is that this country, irrespective of the faulty lines, at 57, we are matured. 57, you don't order a 57-year-old man around.
I wonder, sir.
He is now, talk less of how many you have. I'm sure we have octogenarians.
Of course, sir.
I'm sure we have people who are even...
Septuagenarians,
yeah. We have over 100 and something.
Yes, sir.
Right. So, at that level, it gets to a point as a father in a house, you can only counsel your child. You can't order him about. I don't know whether you know that.
I know.
You agree with me?
Yeah, we agree. Totally, sir. We agree.
You get to a point, if you are wise,
yes,
you will understand that your child has become a friend. And you need to sit down together to discuss.
Father, that's a seat.
Is that not?
Yes, another seat.
That you will discuss with. So if you can do that with your own biological children, how do you now talk about a conglomeration of
identities?
Several
identities and
various backgrounds and what have you. All we need, people say, how do you want to bring about the discussion? It's so simple.
We've had several national conferences.
Wonderful.
But nothing happened. Right. The documents are even almost rotting away. And the President Buhari said he's not even going to do anything with Jonathan's confirm that it's going to be in the drawer.
You see, I'm being very careful.
Okay, sir.
Because I'm not a politician.
Okay, sir. You're trying to.
I'm not a politician, but I'm a Nigerian.
Okay, sir.
So I don't want to behave like a proverbial ostrich that said whatever the hunter is doing, see, as long as my head is in the sand. All that is happening in my nation affects me. And I'm talking on the basis of that.
Yeah.
That I feel ashamed. When I travel out of this country, and all of a sudden people just say, Nigerians, how do you feel?
That's a shame, sir. That's a humiliation.
How do you feel?
No,
you see them, they may just frisk others, but they will frisk you to your underwear.
Pants. In fact, we had the former medical practitioner who was even, he had to put her inside his anus. That was Dr. Ulisa Oje in one of the European countries. They have to even remove his spine and put her inside his anus.
I have not even experienced it up to that.
No, just tell me the drug is
there. No, it's true. No, the medic is correct.
Ulisa Oje, yeah, he said before he died, yeah. That was the end. He said he's not going there again. He's going to be arrogant towards them.
So, what am I saying, my dear brothers, is that when you talk of whether we need to restructure or whatever, I say all we need to do is that Nigerians are not kindergartens. And we are not under military autocracy. We should be able to discuss one with the other. People will tell you we have a national assembly that has a Senate and the House of Rep, and we have the state assemblies and whatever.
You think they can give us solutions?
I will say, to what extent is the man who is in charge of a world responsible to that world? You don't get what I mean?
Yeah, I'm trying to get you, sir.
Now, let me drive the point home.
Okay, sir.
If I'm going to shoot myself in the leg, so be it. Recently, I learned that at the UN, somebody voted for Nigeria against moving the capital of Israel from Tel Aviv to Jerusalem. And I asked myself, I'm a Nigerian.
Representing Nigeria.
Was I consulted? Maybe you, Asabe, And my brother here, you joined, you sent him your decision.
No, we're not consulted. Maybe in the dream, sir. Maybe in our dream.
And I'm yet to hear that it was debated at the National Assembly. That a decision was taken that Nigeria should vote in one way or the other.
In support of
America. No, I'm not even saying this is the way we should. We should be a consensus.
No consultation. So there was no consensus.
That was a sensitive issue.
Very sensitive indeed. A sensitive global issue.
And now it is bringing consequences on Nigerians in Israel.
Including yourself, right.
So they say we should leave.
Right.
And that we don't leave till March. We're going to be behind.
90 days, you are good.
And they're going to give us.
You had confirmation when I was saying that meeting.
They're going to give us money to even.
To leave.
Just leave immediately.
Right.
So who put us in this shit?
Right. Was I consulted?
No, sir.
Were you consulted?
No, sir.
Okay, my pastor was consulted. He represented. Right. So these are some of the things I'm saying. That we say we operate democracy, but to what extent has that been put into practice?
These are very sensitive.
Israel will go to war because of one of their nationals.
I know.
Cast your mind back to 1967, 90 minutes at Entebbe.
Entebbe, under Idi Amin.
Yeah.
And to take all their people.
They are hostages.
They play hijack and the airport hijack.
Under 90 minutes, they evacuated everybody.
Except one woman.
Right.
Died. I know. Israeli are like that.
So, that is one example. There are several other examples. We know what Nigerians are experiencing in Liberia.
Even the 6-day war in Egypt, too.
Wonderful.
Yeah, the 6-day war in Egypt. Just to tell them about
they don't joke with their citizen. For one Israeli citizen, about 120 criminals was exchanged. That is the type of nationalism I'm looking at. That after forget about all of the mistakes of 1914. Forget about all of the what we have had several constitutional reviews. I've mentioned what happened from 1923.
Yes, sir.
We've had another one in 1946.
Yes,
another one in 1951, 1954.
Okay,
1946, 51, 54, and then 1960. Look at those years, 46 to 51. That's just about 5 years.
Yeah.
51 to 54, 3 years. Mm. 54 to 60, 6 years. And even within 1960 and now, we've had several. We have the Constituent Assembly led by Roger Williams and others. We've had so many. Other constitutional review, you told me about the national conference. How many of these have we really sat down to ask ourselves? We've moved from parliamentary system of government, we've moved to presidential system of government. But the thing is, for as long as there is no sincerity in what we do, we are going to hit the brick wall.
Do you think our problem is spiritual?
I doubt.
No. Maybe.
I doubt. Reason.
Yes, sir.
If there's any nation that prays, maybe South Korea's Yonggi Cho. Maybe Yonggi Cho's Korea.
Okay, South Korea.
North Korea.
Okay. The small boy.
Right.
Okay.
Paul Yonggi Cho.
Yes.
Right. The boy that one prays like.
Okay.
If I had 400. Prayer warriors.
Oh, you mean the guy that is threatening America
now? No. I'm talking of spiritual issues.
Easy.
I'm talking of Pastor Paul Yonggi Cho.
Okay.
Who has the largest church? He has the largest congregation in the world presently, and I'm saying I doubt if there's any nation that prays better than Nigeria. Either you talk in terms of Islam or you talk in terms of Christianity.
I agree, sir.
So, I doubt. Our issue is not spiritual. Our issue is greed. Cool. And that's why you could have a nation where somebody could single-handedly sign off a contract that is above the national budget and there is no consequences. Till I speak with you. That is why you could have somebody that is on the wanted list of a government institution, EFCC,
surprise,
being reinstated
into public sector,
public service, and all areas of whatever paid, and there are no consequences. Till today, the man is in thin air.
Yes, with impunity.
Right.
Talking about me now, the
pen. Thank God you are putting names. So I'm just trying to tell some of the, you know, me, I just hear some little news here and there, what have you. So that is the type of question we should be asking ourselves, even though we have 40 lines that brought us together.
And we're also talking about the issue of the herdsmen killing people in Kaduna. They had men killing people in some southern states. And there's no consequences. Right. No arrest has been made. The governor will say, okay, arrest the leader of the BAT, Allah Council Association, this morning in the paper.
Right.
A lot of people are saying, Mr. Buhari, why are you so slow? Why should you declare emergency on IPOB in the southeast and you are hunting Mazina and the Kano? And the man, BAT Allah and his Kawa Association, are still moving freely, killing people days and nights, wasting lives. So, sir, what is the problem? Is this also fundamental issues? If we have a president that went to military school, that appears to be intelligent, appears to be educated and self-enlightened, so why should we have this? And we have another one that is a vice, who's a pastor, a redeemed pastor. So should we not find ourselves in this quagmire at this time?
You are raising very, very profound questions which needs to be addressed. But you see, I will answer in this manner, and I want you to try and decode it. I did a little bit of chemistry. He was my classmate in secondary school. And I want to remember those days, that would be better, maybe he will help me out this time around. I did a little bit of chemistry, and I'm sure he did too.
Chemistry.
Right. I don't know if you can ever get solution out of mixing water and oil.
Mixing water
and oil.
You always remain the mixture.
One will always separate itself from the other.
Yes.
If you boil around, the oil will boil around.
Nigeria continues to find a solution from the mixture. What I'm doing.
That's your submission, sir.
See, and Yorubas have a saying. I'm sorry, I'm from Yorubas talk.
No.
I've just tried to define tribe for you.
Yes, sir.
There's nothing wrong in the tribe. Because the tribe, in fact, is, like I said, defined earlier, is the coming together of several families. And the family is the first unit of man.
Yes.
Where you even learn that you are a human being. Where you learn to love. Where you learn the grace and all what have you. That makes you, how do you relate with the others? So the tribe is in fact something that should be encouraged. But unfortunately, I think we begin to ascribe negativity to tribal affiliations because some Western ethnographers classified tribal affiliation to paganism. And we took again hook, line and sinker. Because the West has said, oh, tribal affiliation borders on paganism or is related to heathens.
According to foreign history.
Right. That's a mistake. I don't take my tribal something as being wrong. Because some of my best friends are not even Yorubas. So, but I'm saying we continue to allow greed to becloud our development. That's why, listen to me.
Yes,
we have a nation where we have architectural structures that will put Roman architecture to task. And yet, those structures are surrounded by walls that will look at Kirikiri Maximum Prison and say, come and learn from me. I don't know whether you're getting what I'm thinking.
So,
That's why you have a nation where you have people that have exotic cars that Mercedes-Benz you come and learn from. Volvo, you come and ask, where do we get some of the type of exotic cars we ride? Japan, you come and learn from us in terms of the type of factories we have.
Factory-fitted cars. Automobiles.
And yet, these cars are driven on some of the worst roads in the world.
I know. We said this so similarly. Even politicians that drive, they have the best clothes, they have the best wristwatch, pick from the best boutique around the world, but they are, the road leaves their house. When there is rain, it's just a garbage.
So, I don't know whether you're getting my point. So, you ask yourself, these ironies that surrounds us and makes us a people. The fault is not in our stars, it's in ourselves. And as I say, it's not spiritual.
Okay.
How can you divorce the fact that when people like us, thank God, he's older than me by 7 years, he's in his early 70s, I'm in my mid-60s, it's also the same range with me. When we were growing, Brother Sabe, look at me.
I feel ashamed, really.
When some of us were growing,
yes, sir.
The pride we had was that we were enrolled in public schools. Because during our time, if you don't have admission to public schools, you are not good enough.
Yes.
So you move with the moral shame.
It's because you are not good enough. That's why because the private schools are just, we will ask you, Omotilewa or whatever is the name of your school. Alright?
I was even coming to that place.
I'm coming. Yes. Ask yourself, what has happened? Those who had the privilege and the opportunity to be trained from such schools, mission schools and what have you, public schools and also what have you, now found themselves as policy makers in educational institutions and also what have you, and they have systematically destroyed the public schools to found private institutions whereby you ask yourself and they tell you education is not cheap. And I say to you, who paid for those educations that people like us attended? So, it's a game. We think we are wise, but we are only being clever by half. You know why? I'll nail it now.
Why, sir?
Because with all of the wealth that you accumulate, with all of the type of structures that you think you have put together, with all of the exotic cars that you drive, you need to have security go around with you every now and again because the society is not safe.
Hostile.
Your children are not safe.
Hostile.
Kidnapping is on the increase. In fact, I'm praying because one of the greatest problems we are confronted with now is poverty in the midst of little affluence. It's an explosion waiting to happen. Explosion waiting to happen. It's an explosive that somebody has ignited. So it's just going. Gradually, I'm praying that somebody will not be driving his exotic car on the road one day and people will just mob him. Let's pray against that. Because in the days you are growing, won't betide you that your mom or your parents find you. In fact, people on the same street with you will have flogged you from their home that they find you walking aimlessly on the street or in an area. Now, the pride is, I'm an area boy. You don't get what I'm saying.
I got it, sir. It's a painful experience, sir.
Now, what led to that?
It's a painful
because experience. We began to encourage people in that area. We begin to
glorify?
To glorify
hooliganism.
We begin to downplay academic pursuit. Let me give you a joke.
Okay, sir.
I learned of a communal gathering, where there was supposed to be a project the community wanted to develop. And then a professor came and presented a blueprint on how the project can
Actualize
the maintenance, the this, that, and what have you, how to be beneficial to all and sundry and what have you. And as soon as he sat down, somebody stood up and said, "Well, me I know hear grammar. This man has been blowing grammar, blowing grammar, blowing grammar. What I will do, I will give you so, so and so amount." And everybody stood up and started to hail him and ask him what have you. And yours sincerely, please let me bring it home. Okay. I stated that as a joke I had, but now let me give you a pragmatic, practical experience that concerns me.
Okay, sir.
I was invited to give a lecture. Myself.
Yourself, sir.
Myself.
Okay, sir. Your humble self, sir.
Yeah. And I delivered the lecture, but when I speak, I am trained to also observe what is happening around my audience. And I could see people.
I'm aware of that. It won't happen in the classroom, sir. When you ask the lecturer too much questions, is it your neck?
So, we need to ask ourselves, how did we and where did we get it wrong? Because the type of fast life, and maybe, we have not noticed also that most of the children of the wealthy ones now, except for a few, most of them are in show business.
Wow.
I don't know whether you observed that.
I observed that. And he's a famous lawyer in this country.
I don't want to mention names.
Yes, sir.
They are either in the show business, hotel business, whatever. Fashion and style. All of those, they won't last.
No intellectualism. Can we call it intellectual paralysis?
Right. And you ask yourself, what exactly? You said you are going to talk about the educational sector. And I'll say to you, the Minister of Education of this country came out openly to say 63 million adults in Nigeria are illiterates.
Okay, you mean the graduate adults? Okay, 63 million. Okay.
Whatever we say, we are 160.
Okay. 63 million.
Whether we say we are 180, okay. Whatever we call ourselves, say out of that 160 or 180, whatever, 63 million, that's about one-third of the Nigerian population are illiterate. And he didn't say, he didn't include children, because he used the word adults. And I was alarmed. And he now went further, after classifying adults as 63 million, accounting for 63 million, he said 11.4%. of children are out of school. If 11.4% of...
So what are they doing out of school? Maybe...
And it's coming from where? Ministry of Education. That's the statistics I'm giving you.
Yeah, that is sensitive source.
Right. Mm-hmm. And now, demographers are telling us, it's worrisome to me if at less than 200 million, we are having the type of restiveness we are having. We are having the type of challenges we are having. We are less than 200 million. With all of the whatever figure we are still less than 200 million. Do you agree to that?
I agree, sir.
Fine.
Very
demographers are now saying between now and the next 33 years, precisely by 2050, Nigeria population will have risen to about 400 million. Our land mass will not expand. Mark you?
Yes, sir. Maybe we need to acquire Cotonou and Ghana.
And we expand to
Ghana. We will live on the Atlantic Ocean. But that is not my problem. My problem is, where are the infrastructures that will cope with that explosion in 30 years
from now?
Who is thinking? Who is planning ahead? What are the number of industries that will cater for that number? I'm saying, if like less than 200 million we are having the type of challenge we are having, double that figure, because that's what they are saying to us, more than double that figure in 30 years. So, Nigeria is failing. I'm painting all of this for you to now tell you that I'm an optimist. To come back to your question, that this nation will survive it. And you know why?
Yeah, why?
You know why?
Why, sir?
For this sitting alone. For the fact that some of the things I interact with on social media.
Yes, sir.
For the fact that some of the things I read in newspapers.
Yes, sir.
Today, I was reading this lady, even though my concern with her is that I wish one day I would meet with her and try to convince her
The Thursday lady,
right.
The back page, our year of election.
Right. I read some of these.
Adelakun.
Adelakun.
Bimbola, yeah, very good writer.
I'm telling you, spot on.
Spot on, very good writer.
Right. It just tells me. You know why?
Yeah.
You know why?
Why, sir?
In any time in history, if there has been transformation, transformation has been brought about not by the majority. It has always been by a few.
I agree. Even the Russian Revolution.
Wonderful.
Even the World War I.
Anywhere.
World War II. Few.
That's even, you are talking of, I'm talking of even issues that borders on support of all governments and what have you. Slavery was brought to its knees because a few people believe that this is not right. This does not agree with our faith. And for 20 continuous years,
they kept on.
The thing is, how consistent will we be? You talked about the next 3 years, and I asked, apart from this type of discussion or interview that we are holding,
yes, sir.
How are we educating the next man to us? What will save us is not a violent revolution. And I said at the meeting I had there earlier today,
yes,
I said, thank God for once, I had the leadership of the Igbo people saying that violence is not the answer to our problem. We need to be more strategic,
yep,
in our demands. And I said, nothing could have been better.
Huh.
I don't think violence is going to lead us anywhere, but I think we could embark on what can be called a silent revolution, where I'm able to convince my brother here. Where I'm able to convince my brother here. He goes on to ensure he convinces Asabe, who is next to him.
Yes, sir.
You take it upon yourself to convince him.
Samuel, yeah.
You have already set in motion a chain of reaction
that
you cannot determine. You see, I'm asking myself that 2019 will determine for me whether Nigerians will ever become wise or not.
That's great. With the kind of hunger, mysteries.
Right? Because you see, if you go to an eatery, the Yoruba said, you finish eating, it's time to pay, you punch the seller. Boppa! There will be another time you'll be hungry. Will you have the courage to come back to the same eatery?
No, sir.
Huh?
No, sir. It's you.
Now, fine. Now, I'm talking in parables. If somebody has been able to convince me or confuse me with flowery promises and what have you, and I can now see that it's a mirage. If I allow sentiment, if I allow emotion
to
be called me when it comes to the usage of my adult suffrage, then a people deserve the type of leadership they get. I'm waiting.
The people also deserve the kind of suffering they get.
I'm waiting. I don't know whether you decode me.
Yeah, I can decode, sir.
So, I think this type of thing, I'm giving my time off, even though I'm very conscious of where we are supposed to be.
Yeah.
Reason, because we have agitated our minds.
Yes, sir.
We'll be very, very frank,
yes,
with one another. Yes. I don't engage in...
Thank you.
No, I tell you.